right, guys. Well, welcome to the 2016 Southern California Loop Fest. This is our panel discussion. Gentlemen, if you'd just briefly introduce yourselves.
Richard Cooper. I am the media production specialist here at Cal State Long Beach.
I'm Lauren Norell. I'm a recording technician at UCLA and a composer and ethnomusicology type person.
My name is Sander Roscoe-Wolf, and I am a musician and longtime looper.
All right, guys. So basically what we want to do is we wanted to kind of take the temperature of what you guys, having had a lifetime of music and technology and academics and arts and performance, and just wanted to get some general thoughts and what kind of trends you're seeing with devices and technologies and programs that are kind of coming under your sphere of influence and how you're putting that out in the world. Anybody want to jump on there first?
Do you want to talk about Max, what you did with trumpet?
Okay, yeah, well, my current thing right now is modular synthesis. I'm really into the Eurorack thing, but for a while I was heavily into Max MSP programming. I've taught classes in it, and I'm going to be teaching a class in it next semester. Actually, next semester's class is going to be half modular synthesis and half Max MSP. We're going to be exploring the ideas of patching theory between the two mediums. But what Sander's talking about is, I wrote a piece, since we're talking about looping, I wrote a piece several years ago, and it's based on Robert Fripp's Frippertronics, which is Eno's, which is actually Terry Riley's, and go back in history, but it's the idea of a continuous loop that you can overdub into. And so what Fripp would do is he would, you know, play the root of a chord, and then as it came back around in the loop, he would play the third on top of it, and come back, he'd play the fifth on top of that, and build chords up monophonically that way. And I thought it was a brilliant way to compose. So I wrote a piece for Rob Freer, who was the head of our trumpet. He's our trumpet teacher and head of brass here. And I did the same thing, except instead of using two reel-to-reel tape decks, I used Logic. I originally did it in Max MSP and then later made a performance version in Logic with just a series of echoes. And so you would play a note in, and that note would get put into a very long echo and come back at a prescribed time. So you could play, like I said, you could play a note on top of that, a note on top of that. You made stacks of notes. The bottom one was forever falling away while you were adding the new ones, and it modulated through keys as it did that. I did all the math beforehand. And when I got it done, I made a video of it with four cameras, and I chopped the video up into levels just like the loops, just like the audio loops, so it loops of video on top of loops of audio. Came out really nice, and I was really happy with that process.
How did you do the looping in Logic? What was your
I'm really into the environment window. I got really into the environment window. It's amazing what you can do if you dig into that in Logic. It's not quite as robust as Max MSP, but you can do some, you know, you can do lots of different routings into different delays and things.
So you're using like the standard delays that were in Logic?
Mm-hmm.
Space Designer.
This was actually before.
Echo Designer. It's something designer.
Yeah. It's a delay designer. Yeah. No, this is before that. I was just using the standard tape echo. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then Rob now performs it live. He put it on his album. And it's funny because he put it on his album with some Bach and some Beethoven and things. Because he's a you know, well known classical trumpet player, and everybody likes my piece best.
So, follow-up question for the Max and the modular synth. Why are you pairing those things together?
Well, because Martin Herman, who he used to be the head of composition here, and he's now the head of design. He's a Max MSP guy. He usually teaches our Max MSP class, and I teach the electronic music classes. But he and I were talking about the similarities in patching techniques between patching a modular synthesizer together and creating things in Max MSP, where the creative aspect comes from the patching and the nested loops of complexity that you can create by you can do it in both platforms. It's actually easier in Max, because once you get something really complicated, you can make that into an object and bury it in another object and keep going sort of fractally forever. Same thing. I've got a large Dofer modular system, and you can do some incredibly complicated patching things that trigger things that trigger other things. It's like an elaborate musical game of mousetrap. So the techniques that I've developed in both of those, we thought would be really applicable, you know, one to the other. And so the students are excited about it. So we decided to teach a one-time class on that subject.
There's also, when we get into the module, there's also some, I'm starting to see some looping modules coming to the Eurorack system. I mean, they're basically designed as loopers instead of delays and stuff, so
yeah,
it brings it right into the whole system.
I don't know very much about that yet. I haven't dug into that.
Yeah, I just saw someone announce one a couple of weeks ago, a stereo sampling module that also does looping. It was designed for looping. And then Dave Rosen of EMU fame, he's starting to do some Eurorack modules, and he's got a, he's basically going to have an EMU emulator for sample module in the Eurorack system. You can probably use that too. I mean, that's a little bit different than using looping devices, but you can still loop audio, you know.
You've done a few performances, and do you include live looping as part of your performance environment?
Yeah, I did a couple of festivals, and I mainly use this program called MainStage, which is an offshoot of Logic that Apple put out. So I have that on my laptop, and it's got a built-in phase looper on it. So I play gamelan instruments live sometimes, and so I'll play one part of a piece, and then loop it in, and I'll do another part. And with MainStage, it's kind of like Max in that you can build your own system, but it's not as open as Max is. So it has little modules you can build. So I sometimes put three or four looping modules on a page, and I can use them for different things and stuff. It's really very simple. All you can do is just loop, or you can reverse this out, and that's about it, as far as I know. The newer version may be different. I haven't tried it out yet. But also, sometimes I use live pedals. I borrowed a pedal from Lou once for a show, and I have some. I have a Jamman and a Digital Echoplex I use now too. So for more esoteric stuff.
But in your studio work, I know that you've done tape looping. Is that something that you still tackle?
Not so much. I mean, that was a lot of fun, but it's like my tape recorders aren't working anymore. So, but I do like digital looping now. I'll record something in, like the Echoplex or something, and then I'll slow it down, reverse it, and then have that go into the background and play some stuff over it and stuff, and then re-record it as a track. So, yeah.
As long as you brought up analog tape, we should just mention the project we did at City College. One time, both Sandra Vorn and I all went to Long Beach City College back when they had a recording program.
An amazing electronic music lab there.
It's fantastic.
Yeah.
Now it's gone due to budget cuts. But at one point I got into the Frippertronics thing, and I wanted to see how far you could push this idea. So I had a tape loop that went from the electronic music studio out the door, down the hall, around the corner, and down the main hall of the music building, all around mic stands. It must have been a 60, 70 foot tape or something like that. And people were going to class, walking past it, seeing this tape running down the hall. And I can't remember how long the delay was, but it was stupid.
It was stupid, yeah.
Well, it was like 56 feet. It's 15 inches a second.
Right.
You can figure it out.
But it was, you put a sound in it, just sit around and wait.
I did an album several years ago called Book of Alchemy with a song called Essence, which had tape loops. And yeah, one of my longest tape loops was about 50 feet in my little private studio. Went from the studio out in my bedroom, back into the studio, and into the bathroom, and through into the tub. And yeah, so.
Putting it over doorknobs.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
The old school way of doing it.
Yeah, and a lot of the looping that I did early on was tape looping, and then you had two digital delays.
Yeah,
you did some shows, I remember, back in the 80s with that.
And I was really enamored of the classic Frippertronics style of looping, which was based on loops that would slowly fade out over time.
Right.
And I'm still enamored of doing that with my voice. I play guitar, I use my synth and things like that, but there's something really, really pleasurable about live looping with your voice. It's really, really fun. It's very immediate, and I find it sort of sublime.
Are there any technology changes in the recent past or
future that you're looking at for your rig and what you're looking to do and upgrade, and how is that going to kind of affect your performance?
Well, now that you've just mentioned that there's finally loopers coming out for Eurorack, I would like to do that. I consider what I do with Eurorack looping, but it's all analog sequencers. Mm-hmm. Like I have six analog sequencers, and they're all doing their own thing, and I'll bring them in and then change which modules they're going to. So it is, in essence, looping, although I could just reach up and change the notes. But now that you're saying there's audio looping available, I think mm-hmm. I'm going to try to incorporate that as well.
Yeah, I've been looking at that too. I mean, a lot of my sound sources when I did the show here was mostly pre-recorded sounds that I, you know, I did sound design on of like field recordings that I manipulated and twisted around. And so that's what Mainstage was basically just a sample player. I was thinking maybe at some point I'm going to try just doing like a Eurorack concert, but I would need something to play out these sounds. So that's why I started looking around for these, you know, sample players and loopers and stuff. And I actually bought a kit called, it's called Radio Music.
Oh, I have that.
You have that kit?
Yeah, actually.
Oh, yeah. It's designed to mimic like a John Cage kind of piece. Mm-hmm. So, and you just fill it with different sounds and kind of randomly pick the sounds and stuff.
Yeah, but it's hard to trigger it on purpose. It's a little glitchy.
Yeah, I haven't finished it yet. So,
as far as new stuff, I use two kinds of looping. I use phrase looping, and for the phrase looping, I use a Core K Oscillator Pro, and it has four stereo channels that you can just basically fade up and down, turn on and off. And so I use that a lot in toaster music. That's my primary looper when I perform. But I also have a DD20, which is the Giga Delay, and it's a stereo looper, and I think it can go up to like 24 seconds or something like that. But I usually keep it around somewhere between 8 and 12 seconds. And in this set, I'll be using that as an old school Frippetronic style looper. So as I play things in, they're slowly fading out, and I'm adding things on top of, front of, behind of. But you know, one of the things that I've been sort of frustrated by is the lack of new hands-on hardware looping. The only one that even caught my eye a little bit was the 505, mm-hmm. which has a great feature set, but the build quality to me is just not road ready.
Mm-hmm. It's Cork?
No, it's
Boss.
Yeah,
Boss.
Most of the pedals I see, or looping pedals I see now, are mostly phase or phrase loopers. They're not really designed to do Frippetronics type stuff.
That's correct.
And a lot of them don't do a lot of the tricks like, you know, half speed and stuff like that. So
right. That'd be like the Infinity Looper.
Yeah, or Looperlative.
Or maybe the Boomerang.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But stereo would be. That's kind of something I would desire too. I mean,
okay. Yeah, for me it has to be stereo, mm-hmm. and a lot of them aren't. Mm-hmm. And then I have to have the long delay times, mm-hmm. Which is absolutely critical, and a lot of them don't.
Right.
Like I think the first one you mentioned goes up to 5 seconds.
Yeah, the Infinity, yeah.
Yeah, I think it goes up to 5 seconds. And my minimum is 8, right. And I often go longer than that. And so that's one of the challenges. Like the 505 would be a great phrase looper for me, I think, to replace what I have in the K Oscillator Pro.
Mm-hmm.
But the other thing that I really like about it is that each channel has its own set of effects and filters,
mm-hmm.
Which is something I don't currently have, and that's something I miss. Mm-hmm. But it seems like there's an opportunity for someone, perhaps Chord, to come up with something new that uses their current feature set and even perhaps their current model of the K Oscillator system,
mm-hmm.
with this layers of capability built into it. That would be so amazing.
Mm-hmm.
But also, you know, there's tons of things that are software based. If you're willing to work with a computer in your performance rig, the opportunities are endless. There's all kinds of amazing. There's even I forget what it's called. There's a software looper that's a model of the
Mobius.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Mobius is something that I've dreamt about running on a laptop with my system, but I just refuse to bust out a laptop for my system.
We should talk about that, because I have several friends who are, you know, electronic musicians, and they're all doing the same thing. They're all trying to not have a computer in their system. Mm-hmm. And I understand why, but I think it would be worth talking about. Like, why are you trying to avoid that?
Well, you know, for one thing, I've had some challenges creating, because I'm performing in real time, and I've had some latency issues that I haven't quite been able to figure out. I was trying to do performance running Cubase and playing the synths in Cubase mm-hmm. live, and I was just not quite getting it right. It sounded great, but the latency issues were problematic. And the other thing too is that I like the stability and the purpose-built feel of hardware. Mm-hmm. And
more hands-on.
Yeah, and even like my Ultranova, even though there's layers, it's basically a fancy computer.
Right, yeah.
It's a purpose-built computer, but it has this sort of hands-on, purpose-built, I know if I press this button, it's always going to do this, and there's no thinking about it.
I think that's the key right there, because with modular synth, it's like you can have as much complexity as you want, but each module does its thing.
Right.
Well, of course, there's a couple digital modules that I have that do multiple things, but mostly, if you reach out to get that thing, it's there, as opposed to a computer, it's always different. I think that's maybe the reason that people are gravitating more towards, you know, specific things that do specific tasks in your system.
Well, I think, that brings up a point about what you tried using Cubase. Your DAWs, I don't think, are very good for doing live performance. I tried doing a show once with Logic, and I was sitting cross-legged on the floor with my laptop there, and actually hit the key with my toe, and I lost everything.
Oh my God.
So, it was hard enough as it was, go through different tracks to get up the sound I wanted. So I think if you want to do laptop use, it's best to find something that's specifically designed for live performance.
Right.
So that's why I went to main stage. But there's also Ableton Live, it's like the ultra favorite of everyone. So,
right. And I was somewhat hesitant. That was the other thing too, is a lot of people that I know have used Ableton and used it really well. And one of the things that I've always been a little bit hesitant about is like tackling that learning curve. Like I know Cubase. I've used Cubase since like 1997, and I know it like the back of my hand, and I can navigate through it really well, and I know how to build things in it. But the idea of learning a whole new system was a little daunting for me. And it's not that I couldn't do it, it's just that I wasn't prepared at the time to invest that kind of time. And going with the Ultranova, for example, programming that thing feels like second nature to me. It feels like working on a modular system. It makes perfect sense to me, the modulation matrix, the way the oscillators are connected to each other, and all of that stuff. To me, it's like synthesis. It's synthesis, and I love that.
I don't really use the laptop as like instead of a synthesizer. I still use the hardware, but mm-hmm. the laptop is there as kind of like the conduit everything goes through.
Right.
And instead of like a sampler on stage, the laptop is used for playing the samples back. So, but I mean, the other problem with using computers live, as I found out once, is they can crash.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a major crash during one of my shows once. Happened luckily right at the end of a piece, and I used lots and lots of long reverb, and I was using hardware reverb. I don't use software reverb for this reason, but just the thing ended and just went out for a long time, and everyone thought it was intentional.
Right.
so kind of lucked out. It just like gave me a few seconds. I was okay, back up and running.
Right. Well, when I perform, the only thing I use the laptop for is drums, just because I know I can build a modular drum system, but it's not really where my heart is, and it's so much easier to create drums in software. So that's basically what I'm using for. Everything else is real time.
So are you driving the modular clock mm-hmm. from the computer then?
From a click on the computer,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Gotcha.
Where all the analog sequences are all locked in there. It's a Logic.
Gotcha.
So how are you guys finding this technology affecting your performances and compositions? Is it changing the way you're thinking about music and sound?
Yeah, for sure, with the modular. Like, I mean, it completely changes the way I approach composition, just because it channels you into certain ways of thinking, just like any instrument channels you into certain ways of thinking. I just happen to like this one.
Well, yeah, I mean, every time it's a new piece of technology, it changes how you work. I mean, we all started in the tape recording world, where multi-track tape recorders and
mono synths,
yeah, analog delays and stuff. And then when all the digital stuff came in, you know, I mean, I remember the biggest thing when digital DAWs came out is like how easy it was to edit stuff compared to tape, where you had to get a razor blade. And, you know, I could edit a whole album in a day. I could do maybe do 20 edits on tape. And, you know, so it's definitely changed. And yeah, in the modular world, I mean, that's kind of interesting because it's sort of old school, but it's new school too. It's different format and there's different things. A lot of digital modules coming out that are changing how you work and interact everything together. So that's really changed how we work a lot now.
Yeah. And I'll say too that even though I started out fully ensconced in the world of modular synthesis and analog synthesis and all of that, when I discovered the capabilities of virtual analog synthesis, basically like the keyboard that I have there, the price and the power, so affordable and so compressed into a piece of gear that I can put in a little backpack and run around with, it's phenomenal to me. It's absolutely mind-boggling that the capability of a huge modular synth can be like put into like a little piece of hardware like this big. And
but not just a modular, you're talking to recorder and all the effects. And
right.
When you're spending a few hundred, maybe $1,000 on all laptop and software compared to, you know, tens of thousands of dollars you used to replicate your hardware back in the day. So.
Yeah, I've recently gotten rid of all of my classic analog synth stuff just because I was so tired of having every time I needed to use it.
Yeah.
It's so frustrating, you know. So, and I find that a lot of, especially my students, they equate, when I say modular, they think analog, and they think that they are synonymous, and they're not, right? Mm-hmm. Lots of great digital modules, and not only that, the analog modules that are coming out now, they all work. They stay in tune, you know. So it's not just the format change, it's just buying the stuff that's new, that's going to work for a few years.
Right, right.
But also, going to get a Eurorack run here, but you talk about, I mean, old school synths, you know, you had your Arc and your Moog and Emu, and they wouldn't talk to each other. They were all their own thing. And now you can buy like a remake of a TB303 filter or a Core PS3100 filter, and you can get an oscillator from EMS Synthy, and you can use them all, put them all together in this Eurorack format, and they'll talk to each other and get different things that way.
And you had asked about how technology is changing the way we compose. Well, what I like is that I have my modular set up, and I'm used to it, and I know how to compose with it, and then a new module comes out, and I can put it in there, and it will change, but only slightly, right? It allows me to take this new idea and put it into my pre-existing way of working, which I really like. It's more evolutionary than buying, you know, a brand new polysynth and having to learn it from scratch and changing the way you write completely.
Right. Yep.
All right. So, in terms of what you're doing right now, what are you going to do next year? What is the future holding for you guys and what you have? Like, if you had a budget and you could buy a piece of gear, what would you get?
Well, let me go first because mine's super simple. since I have to start teaching this Max MSP class next semester, and I haven't played with Max in at least two versions, what I'm doing right now is re-entering the world of Max MSP, which has become just amazing, like all the different things that you can do with it now compared to just two versions ago. It's just crazy.
Can you tell us some new features?
I've just really started digging into it, but I know that there's it's a lot more cross-platform now, and it's a lot easier to create like a runtime version that you can save, so I won't have that problem I told you about earlier where you spend 6 months building something and then they upgrade and it doesn't work anymore. Incredibly frustrating. Ways to get out to the real world from Max MSP using Arduino and be able to actually control things like on a modular synthesizer with it. So I'm pretty excited about all of that. So that's my next thing, is just digging into Max MSP again.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to say what I'd get a year from now. But some things I've seen that are coming out in the near future is, like I mentioned, the Dave Rosin sample model for the modular would be nice. And I'd still like to find a decent stereo looper that's not too expensive. I mean, they don't make the ProDiv anymore, but maybe something like that, or not quite as big as that is. The only thing I think it's probably a faster laptop right now for high performance. So still my stuff's so old now. But,
Well, you know, to be honest, there's something that I've been thinking about for a couple of years now, and that's getting into VST development. Hmm. And there's a number of platforms that allow you to do that. Max MSP, I believe, can they export to VST format now?
Mm-hmm.
So, and this, since you mentioned that it's more cross, it used to be Mac only, now it's Mac and PC. So I've actually been thinking about Mac's MSP because it is this robust environment for building stuff from the ground up. And you can start literally with code if you want to, or you can use pre-built modules and assemble them into larger modules and then take all of that and zip it all up and turn it into a little standalone or into a VST. And for me, because I love the capability of modular synthesis and I love the idea of building things, the capability of doing that in a software environment to me is really thrilling. And I've played around with sort of pre-existing digital recreations, like the Arturia has a modular, it's a Moog, the classic Moog modular system. And that's really super fun, but I'm frustrated by it all the time because it has some limitations that were integral to the hardware, but shouldn't be integral to the software. So, I would love to learn Max MSP.
Why don't you sit down in the class?
Yeah, so that's something I've been thinking about for a long time, and I think it's ready now, and I think I'm ready now, and I think that the capabilities of the system might inspire me to move more easily into a notebook or laptop based system in the future.
I guess I'm the lone holdout with Max, but I have other things that are similar, like a Kima system and Korg Oasis PCI card with synth kit that I can get lost in for several decades if I want.
All right, so for the younger loopers who are just kind of coming into this thing and are completely lost at this point, but they're interested in modular synthesis, they're interested in programmable stuff, they're interested in getting into things that are kind of not just, hey, I want to do my rock and roll song on my RC20. They want to do something different. What kind of advice or directions would you have for them? How would you steer them to help them along their way?
Well, I will say first off that there's the phrase looping world, and then there's the Frippetronics looping world, and the two rarely cross over.
Yeah.
And I would really encourage people who are into the phrase looping to take some time and experiment with the Frippetronics looping style. It's a totally different thing. It's a totally different feeling, and it's a beautiful, beautiful environment to play around in. And it's not necessarily for building songs, although you can, but it's for exploration and for creating these slowly evolving sonic landscapes, which, if you haven't had a chance to play around with it, it's so easy to do. I mean, my Gigadelay is not an expensive pedal. But you can use it to create these beautiful, beautiful, slowly evolving sonic landscapes, and I think that if that would be my one big advice is just try a different paradigm.
I would also say that that when you're doing the Frippetronics style looping, it allows for you to be surprised by what's going on. Kind of like the reason that you would improvise with another person is you don't know what you're going to get back based on what you put in, right? Same thing with the Frippetronics style looping is that the loops become so complex that the juxtaposition of things that you've put in one at a time will come back and surprise you and feed back into your aesthetic and like, oh, okay, well, if it's doing that, now I'm going to do this that I wouldn't have normally done. So it is kind of like interacting with another person.
Right. Watch your levels.
Yes, watch your levels.
That's good. Yeah.
And the only other thing I was going to say to advise to young composers who are working on looping is to let your concept drive your technology, not the other way around. We had talked about how getting a new piece of gear can change the way you write, but that's when you already have an established way of writing. If you're just getting into this, I would say have a musical idea and then look at what you need to realize it. Don't just buy a piece of gear and let that dictate how you write music.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I mean, it's really develop your own way of working and don't follow the technology whole. You know, it's more important what you do is what you have. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Although, you know, I do think, though, that you know, certain types of technology can definitely shape what it is that you do.
Well, all technology does.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. Definitely. And you know, when I had the opportunity to do live looping using two Studer open reel tape decks, that opened me up as an artist in a way that I hadn't really experienced before. It was a different, even though I had done live looping before, doing it on two open reel tape decks was a totally different experience than doing it digitally. And the nuances of the technology allowed me as an artist to explore the looping process in a different way.
So your advice to young composers is to get some analog tape?
Yes. Get two open reel Studers. Yes.
I have two, but they don't work.
Those are cheap, right?
Right.
No, but I see a lot of young folks, you know, I go on these forums on gear sluts and stuff, and they're all like, if I only had this piece of gear, I'd be the most awesome composer ever. And it's not really that, you know, you're limiting yourself, you know, you have all your expectations on this piece of equipment, and, you know, it doesn't really matter when it comes down to the end what you use, so your ideas of how you do that.
Yeah, I participate in this online forum called the Producers Hangout, and I mostly go there and hang out for the comedy, because there's a lot of young people who are pad bangers, you know, who are like beat makers, and like once every like 72 hours, somebody's going, I've heard about this thing called music theory. Is there any value to it? You know, and for me, what I always say is, you know, what are your skills? What are your tools? How are you using your tools with your skills to as an artist? You know, and so if you can build more skills, if you can develop more, have more tools, you can grow as an artist. But I think it's good to have skills first before you start looking for tools. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's just my my Western perception of things.
All right, so as all of you have a tremendous amount of time and experience in your various fields with your various stuff, how would you kind of describe how you're thinking about your music and how you're presenting it to the public now?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think one thing is, for the longest time in my classes, my students have asked me, is this possible, is that possible, right? And it's funny because I used to say, okay, this is possible and that's not. And then we got to Melodyne, where they would ask me, is it possible to change the pitch of a note inside of a pre-recorded chord, right, in an audio file? And I'm like, no, of course not. And then Melodyne came out, and now it is, right? So the only thing that's not possible now that my students ask me about is the karaoke question. Can you take a song and extract the vocals completely out of it and have an instrumental version? As far as I know, that's not possible. But just about everything else is. So now that we've taken off all the restraints, that anything you can really think of, either sonically or musically, is possible, what do you do? And so what I've found is that what's happening now is the instrument interface has become paramount. Just like a violinist learns their violin. The violin doesn't change every time they pick it up, right? It's the same instrument, so they can apply a certain amount of nuance and subtlety to what they're doing because they're so intimately familiar with their instrument. That's where I'm trying to get with my modular synth right now. That's why I don't change it a whole lot. I really want to get so intuitive with it that when I don't even have to reach, I don't have to look for that filter. I reach out and there it is. And that way I can express what's in my mind without having to look at the roadmap of what I've created. And so I think that's what I'm heading for is a more intimate connection with a certain piece of gear
or collection of gear, as opposed to constantly bringing new things in, getting rid of old things, so that you're always not quite secure in your instrument. So I think that's what's coming up, is instruments that are subtle enough finally now. We're getting some controllers that have so much subtle control that you have the kind of ability to change the timbre of a sound like a violin or a saxophone. It's not exactly the same, but it's that level of nuance. So I just want to concentrate deeply on one set of parameters and get good at it. So that's what I'm thinking.
I think it's really hard, and if you're talking electronic music, well, to become an expert in an instrument because of the timbral complexities that you can do. Because not only do you have the musical aspect, but you also have the sonic aspect that changes all the time. So it's a lot. I think it's a lot more difficult to have someone become the Jimi Hendrix of the modular synth or something.
Yeah.
I was going to say, the rig that I have over there is the result of many years of distillation. And when my rig, if you look to compare this rig to the rig that I had like 3 or 4 years ago, it's much, much more simple. I had a Novation Nova, I had a Nord micro modular, I had a Roland JX1010. Those are all synth modules. I had a controller keyboard, and I actually had a second Roland MIDI converter for my guitar, so that I would play guitar and it would control all of those synths. Mm. So I had the keyboard controller, I had the guitar controller, plus I had a ton of pedals for the guitar, and I had a mixer, and all of this stuff, I got rid of all of it. It's all gone. All of that stuff is gone now. I have the synth, which is the keyboard, I have the K-Oscillator Pro, and I have my guitar rig. It's just three pieces, and I even got rid of the mixer for myself. We used to run two mixers, now we just have one. I replaced that with a stereo ABY switcher. So for me, I've constantly been trying to distill and simplify and simplify for exactly the reason that Richard was talking about. I don't play the patches that are built into the synth. I always use my own. I create them from scratch. And I don't have that many. I have maybe 12 or 15. And what I'm interested in doing is finding the way to play these parts that are expressive, that allow me to be expressive in the moment. What we do is completely improvised. And so much of that improvisational process is based on being able to, in the moment, do that little nuanced, expressive thing that's necessary to move the piece forward. And, like Richard was saying, you don't want to have to constantly be rethinking and recalculating and, reinventing what it is that you're doing in order to maybe chase the dragon, That's not where I'm at. Where I'm at is trying to get the most nuance, the most expression out of the simplest, most compact, tidy little performance rig. Mm-hmm. And so that's, I've gotten it to where it's as small as I can make it right now, anyway. So.
All right, so on the dangers of gear and upgrades, this is kind of a new conversation that's starting to come out amongst some of the online looper groups, and which is, how much is gear and upgrades and limitations interfering with what you're trying to present?
Used to be a big problem until I just got off of that train, really.
An attitude adjustment?
Huh? Yeah, attitude, and also the modular synth really changed things because it doesn't have software, right?
So, well, some modules do.
Well, some do. Mine don't. Yeah, and I wouldn't upgrade them anyway because it does what I want it to do. And I really like that. I used to spend about, as a musician, I would spend about 90% of my time rebuilding my studio and about 10% actually making music. And I slowly realized that was just stupid. So eventually I stopped upgrading my studio, which means that when my students come to me and talk to me about the newest iPad app that does great stuff, they're a little dismayed because I don't know what they're talking about. It's not that I'm not interested, it's just that I want to do what I'm doing, and I don't want to have to keep changing it every time a new software upgrade comes out, or the new version of something, or whatever. So yeah, I've kind of minimalized everything that I'm doing so to avoid that particular problem, because earlier I mentioned about the Maxim SP I spent 6 months on a drum machine, and a year later it was completely obsolete because of changes in the operating system and in Maxim SP, and that's frustrating.
Yeah, I kind of jumped off that train because some key software I use is no longer being manufactured and supported, so at a certain point it doesn't work anymore. And I still use, I use this old program from Native Instruments called Spectral Delay to do a lot of manipulation of different sounds, and anything past 10.6.8 on your Mac OS, it doesn't work anymore. So, same with some hardware too, the same way. So, I kind of just, out of necessity, jumped off the upgrade train, and that's too much like work for me anyway. It's like, that's what I do every day at work. Upgrade on computers and stuff, in the classrooms and in the studio. So, no, I mean, at a certain point, it's good to just kind of learn the tools you have, like you were saying earlier. And it's just, if they work for you, why fix it if they broke?
Yeah. Right, and I would agree. I think that I was poised. I was right on the precipice of stepping into the modular world. Mm-hmm. And this was probably about 6 to 7 years ago. I was really, really seriously thinking about going into the Eurorack world. And I had a very, very specific, very narrow idea of exactly what I wanted to do. And I thought about it, I priced it all out, it was within my price range, and then I realized that I just couldn't go there because it would never end. I just knew myself, personally, that I would be that guy whose wife had left him, who was living in a little apartment up above, like a garage somewhere.
Bureaucrat.
With a room top to bottom filled with little modules, and I'd be like, they would find me there, all desiccated, and I had the wisdom at that time for myself. I'm not saying it's bad about anybody else. I just had the wisdom for myself that I just couldn't take that step because I knew that my personality disorder or whatever it was would cause me self-harm down the road. So I think, you have to know that about yourself. You have to know how disciplined you're going to be, both with what you have and that drive to expand. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I think for a while I was expanding my rig, and ultimately I came to a point where, I was turning down gigs because it took me too long to set up and tear down.
Wow. Yeah.
So if it takes me longer to set up and tear down than it is for the actual gig, I wasn't going to do it. So with this rig, it takes me much, much less time. I can do it in a fraction of the time it used to take.
That's one thing I struggle with still, a live rig, is getting my system down to size so that's fairly movable. Because I play with a lot of gamelan instruments live, I use the loopers with. So I know that's going to be a given size. And how much more stuff do I want to drag with me? So I have to have a mixer, I have to have the pedals and the effects and stuff. Do I want to have 12 synthesizers like my friend Steve Roach has every time he plays, and 4 laptops, and or go on just, so. That's true. We talk about that all the time. It's like, I'm going to have a really small little setup. I'm only have 6 keyboards.
But that's money when he plays.
Yeah, that's true. That's true, too.
Well, at Lauren's last gig, which was also, I think, your last gig, I had sort of jokingly said that he should just bring a laptop and play his last album, just hit play, and just sit there and
for... Well, I actually took that as a challenge, and I ended up playing a piece off of an album live.
Yeah.
But you told me that you wanted to hear the album Toxie. I actually did Toxie live. So.
Right, right. But he actually recreated it. I was just saying, just play it.
do we have any questions from the floor? Anybody want to ask these guys anything?
So I know you, and I know you. Who are you?
My name is Randy Green.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Sander.
It's nice when you can meet the entire audience.
All right, guys, last thing. What's the favorite thing about the gear you're using right now? What is the feature that is just kind of, you know, just tickling your earbuds right now?
I have this module in my system from, it's called the Nebula. It's it plays samples, but it also does like granular synthesis as well with it, and you can control it with different CD gates and stuff. It's a really interesting module to use. I've been enjoying it a lot. I use that actually live too.
Speaking of granular, yeah, I think that's my new favorite thing is the Clouds from Braids, the Clouds module. It's a granular synthesis module, and I did a piece recently where I just took that and put it through the Echophone, which is a digital recreate. I think it's actually, is it analog? Digital. I can't remember what it is.
It's digital.
It's digital, but it's a digital recreation of an analog delay with looping and stuff inside of it. It's a module. And just with those two things, I just improvised for quite a while and really, really liked what I was getting out of it. So, yeah, I think the granular synthesis in modular, in Eurorack form, is really
in hardware, yeah. Hardware. I mean, it used to be just software.
Oh, yeah, well, Maxim SP is the perfect tool for granular synthesis, but being able to just reach out and do it in real time and improvise with it is wonderful. Mm-hmm. Just taking grains of sound and just stretching them and then shifting them in real time.
Nice. Yeah. Yeah, for me, you know, it's my Ultranova. The Ultranova is like my return to modular synthesis, but it's all virtual and it's all on a pretty blue keyboard. And plus also my guitar, which I call the Sandblaster. I love playing my guitar. It's, you know, it's what Richard was talking about. There's a certain comfort and familiarity when you have your hands on an instrument that you just play and you know, and it responds in a way that you feel just really comfortable with. And it's probably like your saxophone, mm-hmm. You know. There's no surprises there.
Yeah, right.
It's just you can communicate with it. It communicates with you in a way that just allows you. It gets out of the way. It's a conduit for your expression. So.
All right. Very nice. Thanks, guys.